big changes, not only to the way we design things, but to the way we generally think about how we plan, design, construct, and approach the way we design our communities and shape our communities. So I'm going to be taking a little bit of a different lens, a health lens, to this look of complete streets. I'm going to skip this. You don't need to hear more of the bios in the sheet. But in terms of my presentation, I'm going to be sort of taking all of this that we've been talking about today and tying it neatly into hopefully a little bow of how you can sell this to some of the questioners, the naysayers, or maybe consider it in a different light to how we've been talking about it now or how it's come up in your other conversations. So when we talk about health, when we talk about public health, what are we referring to? And here I have the definition. We're talking about the population and disease and restoring health. But what I find really interesting in the work that I do is health actually is not just about the person. It's about the community. It's about how we function. It's about the holistic look of many different features and aspects. So there is logically a very direct connection between health and public health and the built environment. And so when we talk about the built environment, another sort of key term, we're talking about external physical environment where we live, work, and play, all of the services, the infrastructure, the components of our communities, our cities, the areas where we actually function as humans and how we need to do that. And when you break it down, because it's just really so much to think about, it can really be organized into three key components. One, that personal area of focus, but two, the bigger societal considerations and how that's affecting our communities and our world and our country, all of those different geographic factors. And then as we've been starting to talk about a little bit more of the environment, and you'll be very surprised or not, that when you start talking about the health of the people, the communities, and the environment, here's Perka. And suddenly people, including decision makers, are saying, oh, we need to think about this. This is important. We're talking about why this is good and why we need to do this. And it really becomes a very good gateway conversation when you're trying to have these conversations or meaningful discussions around significant changes to the way we design our transportation systems and our communities. So who are we addressing when we talk about health? In terms of the most commonly affected, we have a number of considerations or groups here that I've outlined, everywhere from low income to seniors, to indigenous groups, newcomers. We aren't talking about marginalized groups or those that are harder to reach. We're just wanting to consider those that are typically most affected, but also those that may not be specifically targeted in some of our work day to day. And in terms of the key trends that are being experienced right now from a health perspective, there are three primary trends that our work is typically focusing on and that are those target areas for what we should be considering. The first being climate change, as we've talked about before. The second being how new technology integrates with that, so how we're adapting to how technology is influencing our lives and how it can interchangeably help to improve our lives. And then equity. And I think that a number of us today have touched on a number of different aspects related to those three top categories. But sub to those, there are even more nuanced considerations when it comes to health, which the way we design our communities and the way we design our transportation networks have an additional direct impact on mental health, the economy, how people are injured, you know, Vision Zero, as we've been talking about, the air quality and physical activity. So there are so many different health impacts, outcomes, and aspects that the way we design and, again, the way we develop and construct have a direct influence on. So in terms of research and documented impacts in the three top categories, there are a number here on this slide, including higher loads or pressures, flood, low-carbon buildings, valued green space, that are being talked about in this lens and this aspect, but in terms of the transportation and sustainable transportation component, looking at walkable neighborhoods, access to active and public transportation, these sorts of influences or impacts do have a direct influence, as I said before, on climate change and how this is becoming part of our communities. In terms of technology, while we have a number of the considerations, using technology to influence our behaviors is a really new and emerging way of how we are going to be addressing some of those key concerns. Integrating that, we don't have necessarily Uber here, as I found out last night, but other ways where the taxi companies are using technology to track rides or track your behavior, track your movement, their movements, and trying to use that to influence how we move around. And last but not least, the health equity. So looking at the most vulnerable individuals, looking at how people move around their communities when we have to consider people of all ages and abilities, as well as designing those aspects that will help directly influence on people's movements and their experiences. So how does it apply? When we're talking about sustainable transportation and complete streets, active transportation being included obviously in that, there are more direct influences and impacts. And on this slide, I have a number of icons which represent the different considerations. And in our opinion, and based on the research that we have, in terms of mental health, climate change, physical activity, and technology, there are some of the most direct connections and direct influences. And it's important to consider those features or those aspects when you are creating that rationale or that argument towards investing and putting support behind these new improvements. In terms of influence, our public health pillars that are driving our communities have quite a direct influence and a correlation with our planning pillars. And Dan was talking about the high-level planning considerations, and that is my bag, I will admit. But I do think it is quite critical and important to speak that language and to provide that rationale in addition to focusing on some of the details and the specifics. So while our public health considerations are quite unique in themselves, there is some good connection between the two and understanding their relationship between the two of them. So we've talked quite a bit about policy and its influence. And what I find when I have conversations with either my engineering colleagues or my health colleagues or decision makers is there sometimes can be a lack of understanding of the different layers of policy and how they influence and how critical it is to have different considerations within each of these policy documents. So we talked a bit earlier about where it can be most influential, but when we're looking at influencing policy and putting forward complete streets policies and considerations, usually around the higher level provincial policies, the official community plans, and the master planning level is where we find it to be most effective. It has that bigger amount of clout and support that you can provide as you move forward and move towards the guidelines. And it also provides that higher level thinking that guides and envisions community growth, development, and how we move forward with what that looks like. So in terms of the planning topics that we think about, there are five key topics in that: physical activity, social interaction, food access, connection with nature, and housing. And those have a very direct influence on topics like air quality, injury, mental health, and equity, which, as I circle back, are the top categories that we spoke about that complete streets and active transportation and sustainable transportation. So there are very direct connections, and the health lens is a complement, and data that health can provide, as well as information that they can provide that rationale, is a key piece of the puzzle in some cases to get that bigger picture involved. So in terms of some considerations for the design and the approach to some of our community and transportation development and design, for air quality, looking at different ways that you can integrate active transportation into overall roadway design, prioritizing transit. There's sort of a wide range that we outlined here, including trails, prioritizing bicycle parking that we talked
incentive programs to encourage or to encourage reduced motor vehicle use. So it's combining not just health, but also the outputs and the inputs of transportation influence in order to see those changes. And for me, when I started working with more public health practitioners and creating the connection between complete streets and sustainable transportation and health, it was very surprising to me to learn how they think about the influence and sort of their line of consideration. So while we think of the strict relationship between maybe air quality and reduced number of single occupancy vehicles, they have a very different interpretation. And it's, that is why I asked the question about who's at the table when we talk about these guidelines and these documents, because they can provide really interesting ones. In terms of integrating complete streets into road classifications where we can, developing those guidelines, developing supportive policies, restricted pedestrian access, blue lighting stations, something very specific but considerable here, integrating principles of crime prevention through environmental design, SEPTED also knows that, and considering a plan for Vision Zero. So again, very wide ranging from more of that higher level policy down to the details of design. Mental health, looking at encouraging social interaction, designing facilities to provide access to community services and green space, providing opportunities for the use of AT, active transportation for recreation, and creating environments that support a greater level of comfort and every trip facilities. Mental health is a bit more nuanced, and we're learning more about the direct connections between transportation and mental health, and also community design and mental health, but it is a considerable aspect of community health and something that is coming to the forefront in many of the council discussions that we're hearing, as well as the rationale. In terms of equity, so providing active transportation facilities that connect to low-income areas, we were having a conversation earlier this morning about what that could look like, the use of geographic information systems to try and target specific areas and link different connected points can be very useful, providing routes and facilities that make active transportation more viable, designing for users of all ages and abilities, integrating principles to access for all, as well as providing amenities. These are just some general principles and suggestions that have been built into based on practices and what we've seen emerging, but it is very much based on your community and your understanding of the community and what its needs are. So why is it important to address health as it relates to complete streets, complete communities as a wider range of discussion, as well as we talked a lot today about context-specific considerations. Each municipality, each neighborhood, each community is going to be very different. And we need to try and find a process and a way to respect those considerations and design for those as best as we can. Addressing challenges in the existing policies and plans. In many cases in the communities where we go to, there isn't even any mention of complete streets or sustainable transportation or health in some of the critical documents, and that is one of the first areas and points of influence that can have some various effects or trickle-down effects as we move forward. Determining a base level of understanding of trends. So when you're talking about trying to influence change, you want to know where you're starting from. So we need to understand what is currently happening in the community in order to influence and change our growth and development. In terms of improving communication between public health practitioners and other staff members. That is a very specific recommendation, but I do feel as though they're very critical and important champions, as well as stakeholders in the process, and their input and their influence can have a very strong effect on rationalizing and arguing for supporting why these improvements and these investments are so important. Identifying best practices, that advanced planning and development. So build on what's happened, build on what you've seen, and you've heard a lot of those great examples today, and great examples of where things worked, where maybe there are lessons learned, and it's important to use that as a basis, but also, again, build in that context as a consideration. And integrating communication with key stakeholders and the public. Again, that was a bit of a planted question I asked Tyler, because do think, even though it's not about having the public's input at all stages, it's about hearing from the right groups at the right point in time to shape the outputs and shape the outcomes so that they're the most appropriate and going to be the most realistic. So in terms of who to involve, we talked a little bit about the different levels or the different groups that we could bring into these conversations. I don't think by any means this is a limited list. It's very important to think of, you know, all the potential audiences. These are sort of the key groups that we tend to hit on when we have these conversations and when we try and influence that change. A lot of them have just a wide range of opinions, and that's very important in order to understand maybe the variation of challenges that we need to address, but also generate some really interesting ideas on solutions and ways to address them specific to the community that we're talking about. So the last slide that I have, or one of the last ones I have, is so then how do we actually address this? How do we build health and healthy considerations and healthy communities into our processes and into our active transportation and complete streets conversations? Research, first and foremost, so understanding the community, understanding the best practices, and looking at how we can build that into our consideration in the local context. Scanning some of the other research documents or the trends that we're seeing as we move forward and looking at those specific neighborhoods that we want to speak to or within the specific roadway or context that we're discussing. Engagement, engaging the key audiences and groups so that we can actually leverage their support, leverage their input, and use that as a foundation of understanding. Prioritizing what the improvement to be understanding that maybe we can't tackle every single street or every single road, but understanding where some of those valuable improvements could be in order to create some great change. And then policy in action. So creating that policy change, creating those guideline foundations, and making action out of those. So building that into day-to-day practice, building that into day-to-day considerations so that the question doesn't come up, why are we doing this? Why is this? Well, we're creating complete communities, we're creating complete streets, we're creating healthy environments, we're creating healthy people and healthy places for people to be. And all of that, I think, really stops the conversation in a really positive way when it comes to trying to get everybody at the table, trying to get everybody to support these changes that we're experiencing for the better within our community, to make it more healthy, to make it more sustainable, to make it more environmentally supportive, and to really adapt to some interesting changes that we're seeing in technology, in behavior, and in just general human interaction, which is, I think, why we're all here. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think that's one of the reasons why we're all here. So thank you very much. That was meant to, again, a little bit of a bow on all of that. I know it's a lot to take in. And it is very unique to each area. So I'm happy to take some questions if you have any. If not, we can maybe just have a little bit of a debriefing conversation about the day. Talked about a little bit earlier, and I think that's